It's outrageous. It's arrogant. It's excessive. It's larger than life. It's relentless. Flashbackin.
Welcome to Relentless Flashbackin. This is your misogynistic host, Joey Cruel, and this is a special episode about the Spray Regal story. I have a special guest tonight, Rob De Luca, the best player from Spray Regal. Let's start from the beginning. Massachusetts isn't quite the first state that you think of when you think about hard rock and heavy metal, and the list of bands that made it is really short: Aerosmith, Boston, Extreme, and a few others. Yet, our story begins right in Boston, where three Italian-Americans, Paul Di Bartolo, Rob De Luca, and Tommy Gallo, found a band named Bang, together with Michael McGovern. A series of gigs without satisfaction and with many disappointments dragged the band for 4 long years. They also managed to do concerts in New York, but a few interested labels aren't satisfied by the singer, so they decided to move to New York and look for a new singer. Meanwhile, 1,400 miles away in Fort Lauderdale, Florida, another band, Defiance, is chasing success in a scene that is in some way more alive. In 1990, their singer receives an offer, and Ray West, originally from Brooklyn, spoke about his return home. "I was invited by my soon-to-be manager to come to New York City and join a band that was doing showcases. Meanwhile, the Bang manager needed a singer for their project. I was torn between two bands, but we thought the sound of the boys from Boston was a better fit for me. But remember, I was joining a band with three new guys who had a different singer, were from a different town, and there was a very getting-to-know-you process. So the name Bang is dropped in favor of Spray Regal, and they began to write songs together, and they continue to rehearse. And only after a few months, right outside the rehearsal studio, the dream finally becomes reality. You had about 9 or 10 bands all signed at once, from Law and Order to Jet Boy to us, and it was a time when labels were just grabbing a bunch of bands all at the same time. It was almost like they just threw a bunch of dice out to see what they rolled. We got signed, only having about 5 or 6 tunes, but we got signed out of a rehearsal studio, which was really almost unheard of. Before the record was released by MCA, Spray Regal acted with military strategy and filmed the video for Scratch Like a Cat with their own money.
Yes, that is true. We used our own money and favors to film the Scratch Like a Cat video. That video came out before our album was even released. It came out like 3 weeks or a month before our album was even released, and we were on MTV Headbangers Ball before our album was even released. And we were on tour with Vain before our debut album was even released.
Can you tell us more about the tour with Vain?
Well, the tour with Vain started great and ended bad. We were really crazy back then. No one could tell us that we couldn't have something, that we couldn't do something, that we couldn't succeed at something. It was four of the most driven, aggressive, dedicated guys you could ever meet in one band. So we went out with Vain, and we were getting a really good response from the crowd because their debut video was on Headbangers Ball, and our debut video was on Headbangers Ball. So we were drawing as many people as them. And I guess we were just really, really too much for them, and they threw us off tour. Too much meaning just we were so aggressive and so crazy. So they threw us off tour. And I guess in hindsight, you know, the support act has to show a lot of respect to the headliner. But it was hard for us to look at things that way, because everything to us, when we were on stage, we were the headliner. That was our attitude. So since then, I've done shows with them. I've talked to them, and we're all friends. And I think they're a really good band. So it's all good now.
During the recording of the first album, some toxic ideas crawl inside the record plant in New York, and the management has some brilliant ideas to make the record, let's say, quote-unquote, better. To ask Tommy to not play drums on a song and bring in another drummer, that's not right. You don't ask that to people on their first record. As a matter of fact, that happened also to me on the first record. We were doing Broken City, and the management brought in another vocalist to redo it, because they didn't think I was doing it right. Then the new vocalist listened to it, but finally mentally was like, I can't do this. No one can do this. You already did it. I don't know what the hell they want. The first album is aggressive, savage, untamed, and brutal. In fact, Ray said, that record was recorded on a sheer anger and alcohol. But this record is also incredibly honest. Apart from some naive and tasteless lyrics, the rest of them speaks about life lived in the worst blocks of New York City. A city that doesn't forgive. So much that in 1975, the police distributed a tourist guide called Welcome to Fear City. Spread Eagle dedicated two songs to the Big Apple. Broken City, in which they describe it, in fact, full of fear and rats, and the instrumental 42nd Street,
which is one of the most famous streets in Manhattan,
which crosses it from east to west. This street was already quoted in the 1980 song The Zoo by Scorpions, and in the 72 track You Don't Mess Around With Jim by Jim Croce,
a song that was also covered in 1986 by Poison. Rob, do you still live in the city that never sleeps?
I still live in New York City and Manhattan in the same neighborhood as I did in 1990. I'm seven blocks away from where I lived back then. And it's still the most incredible city in the world, but to be honest, it's nowhere near as dangerous as it used to be. It's gotten somewhat gentrified and safer, cleaner, which is good and bad. It makes it more expensive to live here. It makes it harder for artists to live here. Of course, there's still rats because it's a big city. It's changed a lot, but I still love it. It's my favorite place in the world. It's my home, so it's still the broken city to me.
New York City's crime rate has fallen to levels not seen since the 1950s. The NYPD says there have been 289 murders this year. That's down from a peak of more than 2,200 in 1990.
I can understand what you are saying about the New York gentrification. Michael Moreau even released a song about it, Ballad of the Lower East Side, in the 2013 album Urns and Aloes. And now, from the first Spray Regal album, here is Broken City. Holy cow! That's the type of song that you choose to open your album and to say who you are. On the first album, there is a big thank you to Bruce Dickinson. At the time, he was the MCA vice president. After 1993, Dickinson, before retiring, will work for Sony.
I don't know much about what happened to Bruce. Bruce is the guy that Saturday Night Live has the parody skit about producing Blue Oyster Cult and asking for more cowbell. Christopher Walken.
My name is Bruce Dickinson.
That's the guy that signed us. He was a real person. And not the singer of Iron Maiden, obviously. And I don't know what happened to Bruce. He was always really great to me and great to us. He was a very honest, straightforward guy, and we really appreciated him. And we never had a problem with him, and still don't. And I hope he's doing well.
Oh yeah, that's one of my favorite sketches from the 25th season of Saturday Night Live that aired from 1999 to the year 2000. Actually, there is a mistake, because the 76 album Agents of Fortune was produced by David Lucas, Murray Krugman, and Sandy Perlman. In fact, Bruce Dickinson was only involved in the remastering of the first Blue Oyster Cult albums during the 90s. But you know, it's only a sketch, and it's a really great and funny sketch.
I didn't know that about Bruce Dickinson, that he was involved in the mastering. But yeah, that's a great sketch, the cowbell sketch. It's amazing.
I got a fever! And the only prescription is more cowbell.
After these fast years full of adrenaline, the time comes for the second album. But the drummer Tommy Gallo is fed up and leaves the band in 1992, so the drums are played by session players. Now the band is more experienced. The singer Ray West said about his progress.
On the first record, I did an awful lot of screaming.
Now I just wanted to show that I could get it done, go from left to right. Paul DiBartolo continues to talk about the comparison. On the first album, we were completely frustrated, pissed off punks, really angry when we were doing the whole thing. These were more setlet time, and we just got to really show our musicianship on this new record. Unfortunately, Open to the Public is an hodgepodge. And yes, the band during the composition listened to different types of music, but the real cause are the external interferences, with conflicting requests. As Ray confirms, we got manipulated, of course, on the second record.
record, it was annoying. We did everything, from A to Z on that album. Thus, you have a very confused record. Open to the Public is less sleazy and angry than the first album, but there are still great songs with the old attitude. Revolution Maker, If I Can't Have You, and the devastating King of the Dogs. What was the inspiration behind King of the Dogs?
I'm pretty sure it's about police brutality and the riots that took place in Tompkins Square Park in the East Village of Manhattan, New York, in the summer of 88. Our singer Ray West wrote the lyrics to that song, so I think he would be better at giving the details of it.
The song King of the Dogs, that comes from being witness to the riots at Tompkins Square Park, which we both, you and I, lived through. So the story was, I was a homeless person, and he said, they're acting like a pack of dogs, they were just beating people. And someone pointed out a cop on the corner, he said, that's the king right there. And he was all cocky, just standing there, like, firing orders and looking all happy. So that really inspired the song.
Awesome.
Whoa, we got Ray West too! Thank you for the answer! I suspect that the policeman firing order was the Captain McNamara. The riot took place in one of the poorest neighborhoods, with the usual, as you said, police brutality, that while using racist insults, they beat protesters, homeless people, passers-by, shopkeepers, and even members of the press. As witnesses and the videos can tell you, the riot is still etched in the memory of the citizens. In fact, not only Sprague Eagle spoke about it, but also Lou Reed and the Undead recorded songs about the disorders. And now let's listen to King of the Dogs! And that was King of the Dogs, a totally radical song. The second album is released in Japan in 1992 and in the rest of the world in 1993. The reception isn't great. After all, we are in the swamp of sadness. Grunge has taken over the world and the writing is on the wall. Ray revealed their nefarious intentions. I think we could have adapted to. We were writing heavier tunes between the second album and what we thought be our third record, and we were going in a really heavy direction. Luckily, this third album was never recorded, and the contemporary Subhuman Race by Skid Row, Wasp Bones by Tiger Tales, and the eponymous album My Motley Crue, which were enough to fill our soul with bitterness and disappointment, can give us an idea of the band's ill direction. We all know what happened in those dark and terrible years, starting from September of 1991, and I don't want to repeat myself. And I know there is utopistic and crazy to think that hard rock and its ramifications could remain in the spotlight forever, but the crime was, as we know, that most of the bands, both old and new, were prevented from continuing to exist.
I agree with you. Ultimately, there's good music and bad music. There's two categories. Although I think it's healthy when something new, fresh comes in and shocks everyone enough into looking at things through new eyes, like, for instance, what happened with Nirvana, what happened with Guns N' Roses, what happened with the glam scene of the Hollywood Strip, what happened with the reaction to that scene in San Francisco with thrash, what happened in 1967 with the Summer of Love and the psychedelic music that also came out of London with Pink Floyd. When that happens, a musical and sometimes cultural revolution, I think it's healthy. However, with the concept of that's the only thing that's good and everything else sucks is ridiculous. So when that toilet flushed in the early 90s, a lot of really good bands went with it that should have had more time to develop. So it's sad how that happened. Some of the bands that got washed away were actually pretty damn good.
What I can say, I totally agree with you. In 1994, Sprayer Eagle, as expected, split up. But, as they say, it's not over until the fat lady sings. So they returned in 2006. Moreover, in 2008, Rob De Luca joined UFO, while still playing with his band. Finally, in 2019, thanks to Frontiers Records, they released a third album, Subway to the Stars. Let's talk about it. Of course, the sound of the new album is different. As you said, you can never truly go back in time. Everyone learns and evolves. So how do you describe the sound of Subway to the Stars?
I think it's a classic Spread Eagle album. Yes, you're right, you can never truly go back in time, but you know, we've grown, but we haven't changed. We still have all those street metal sensibilities about us, but we've grown as songwriters and arrangers. And I think this album is a perfect example of where we are right now, and all four of us are incredibly proud of it, and the fans are reacting very strong. That's our main gauge. If the fans like it, we know we're doing something right. So every indication so far is that we've made the right record, the record that our fans have been waiting for. And another thing is, if you're going to wait 26 years, you can't deliver a mediocre record. It's got to be among the best of your catalog, because your fans are going to be very angry if you deliver a mediocre record after 26 years.
The artwork for the cover is interesting. It seems to be a normal subway car, but the door leads to a never-ending aisle. What's the story behind this cover? The subway noises that you can hear in the album and the title, Subway to the Stars.
Well, for us, we live here in New York City, so the subway, we get on it and we ride it every day, often multiple times in a day. So the subway takes us everywhere. So I used it as a metaphor for, you know, our dreams and taking us, you know, to the stars, to anywhere. I think it works really well. And our drummer, Rob De Luca, had the idea to do the sounds of the subway car in between songs, which I thought was really good. And the album cover and art and layout is done by Tristan Greatrix. I've worked with Tristan for over a decade in the band UFO. He does all our album covers and posters and backdrops and things like that. So Tristan Greatrix is a really fantastic artist. So yeah, it's a trippy kind of cover. It's almost like MC Escher, where you think it's one thing and it's not exactly that. So that was his idea, and I think it's really beautiful.
So there is another connection between UFO and Spread Eagle. That's really cool. Your first two albums were released by MCA, and in 1993, when your album, Open to the Public, was released internationally, William Nedelcider published the book Stiffed,
a shocking book that exposed the link between MCA and the Mafia.
Many bands said that the culprit of their demise is the music cemetery of America. Do you agree? Working for MCA was that bad? And is the song from the new album Grand Scam about MCA?
Grand Scam isn't particularly about MCA Records, but it could be. I definitely did not have that in my mind when I wrote those lyrics, but it could be applied to MCA or many other situations where you have to think for yourself. Grand Scam is about thinking for yourself and not following the crowd, not following the herd of cattle. Just because everyone's doing something doesn't mean it's right. That's what Grand Scam is about. However, yeah, there were multiple factors of why Spread Eagle didn't succeed on the level that we should have. MCA is one of them. They're not the entire reason, but they're one of the reasons. Regardless, our fans have stuck by us for 29 years, and that's amazing. So that's a testimony to the music that we created, and that's another reason why we wanted Subway to the Stars to be such a strong record, because we want to show our fans the wait was worth it. And here we are talking about a new record 29 years later, which I'm really proud of.
So now is the right time to listen to Grand Scam from the last Spread Eagle album, Subway to the Stars. And that was the totally awesome Grand Scam. Let's keep talking about Subway to the Stars. I really like the fact that the song, Sound of Speed, is really mean and aggressive, but the video is really playful. What's the idea behind it?
When I thought of the idea for that video, I thought the most obvious thing to do would be to use all kinds of car racing footage and fire and explosions. And so that's actually the last thing that I wanted to do in the video, because I thought it was so obvious. So I thought it would be really funny if we just, you know, were racing go-karts and taking it way too seriously. And I think it came out really great. I'm really, really happy with it. I think it's entertaining and cool and fun video.
Since now Spread Eagle are back on the shelves, do you think that a box with the first two albums, unreleased tracks, and a DVD with new and old interviews, promo videos, live videos, could be possible?
That would be great, but to my knowledge, there is no unreleased music. Basically, we recorded everything that we wrote. We decided before we went in the studio what was going to be on the record. So unless I'm mistaken, there are some old cassette tapes that I can listen through, but basically everything is on album. But interviews, live, DVD, that all sounds great. We'd love to do that.
With this last answer, the interview ends. It was an honor to talk with you, Mr. De Luca, and I want to thank you for your time. I hope you liked this episode, and please subscribe to the channel and follow the show on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. Relentless Flashbackin is easy to find because the name is unique all over the web. If you want to give your support, please visit Patreon. And you can give your support also buying these awesome t-shirts. You'll find the link in the description below. And now, from the first Spreadigo album, here is Susie Suicide. Stay outrageous, stay larger than life, Romeo, Foxtrot, Bravo!